welcome to our worship in this, the fifth Sunday of Lent. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, the beginning of Holy Week, which I believe maybe we have our times and days in the bulletin, letting you know when we're worshiping next week. We have just a handful of announcements for you this morning. Our first announcement is, to everyone who participated with us on Friday night, we thank you very much. If you don't know, I was the one who was murdered. I'm not holding any grudges, mostly. But you missed me dying, which was just so wonderful, right? Yes. Those of you nodding your head will talk. Our other announcement is we ask that you would keep in your prayers the family of Charlotte Wolfenstein. She died this past week from cancer. We have been praying for her for the last few weeks, so please keep her family and her friends in your prayers. And then also, we have another fundraiser to discuss, but I forgot the particulars, so can you help me out, Steve?
Sure. Thank you. So my wife, Karen, is participating in a fundraiser where she's doing about a 15-mile walk through Manhattan. It's for the American Society of Suicide Prevention. I may have the name wrong, but we have she's trying to raise money. She's trying to raise about $25,000. We're already up to $3,000. And it's a great cause. It's for mental health awareness and suicide prevention. It's been a really rough couple of years for a lot of people. And this is a special cause she's trying to do. Her cousin from the West Coast is coming out as well to join her. So we'll send some links around, but I was careful to approach this before any other church-related fundraisers were going on. We'd appreciate any support. If you have any questions, I'll let you know about it. But this is a really great cause that she's doing, and it's through the night. She's going to be walking through Manhattan with thousands of people. It's an organization that's done this all over the country for many years. So more to follow. Thank you.
And if people want to make donations, they can do it online, correct?
Yes, you can do it online. We're trying to find a place you may actually be able to write a conventional check.
But, what are those?
Most of it is, and also free will cash offering is accepted as well, but it is a charitable donation, so it's tax deductible as well. Thank you all. Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you. Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord,
and you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
You may kneel. I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please rise.
Chariot, horse, army, and word. They lie down, they cannot rise.
They are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild beasts will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches, for I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, the people whom I formed myself, that they might declare my praise. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's psalm is number 126, found in the front of your handout.
Chapter. Jesus began to tell the people this parable. A man planted a vineyard and let it out to the tenants and went into another country for a long while. When the time came, he sent a servant to the tenants so that they would give him some of the fruit of the vineyard. But the tenants beat him and sent him away empty-handed. And he sent another servant. But they also beat and treated him shamefully and sent him away empty-handed. And he sent yet a third. This one also they wounded and cast out. Then the owner of the vineyard said, "What shall I do? I will send my beloved son. Perhaps they will respect him." But when the tenants saw him, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Let us kill him so that the inheritance may be ours." And they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owner of the vineyard do to them? He will come and destroy those tenants and give the vineyard to others. When they heard this, they said, "Surely not." But he looked directly at them and said, "What then is this that is written? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces. And when it falls on anyone, it will crush him." The scribes and the chief priests sought to lay hands on him at that very hour, for they perceived that he had told this parable against them, but they feared the people. So they watched him and sent spies who pretended to be sincere, that they might catch him in something he said, so as to deliver him up to the authority and jurisdiction of the government. This is the gospel of the Lord. Morning's meditation is found in Zechariah chapter 10, verses 4 through 12. From him shall come the cornerstone, from him the tent peg, from him the battle bow, from him every ruler, all of them together. They shall be like mighty men in battle, trampling the foe in the mud of the streets. They shall fight because the Lord is with them, and they shall put to shame the riders on the horses. I will strengthen the house of Judah, and I will save the house of Joseph. I will bring them back because I have compassion on them, and they shall be as though I have not rejected them. For I am the Lord their God, and I will answer them. Then Ephraim shall become like a mighty warrior, and their hearts shall be glad as with wine. Their children shall see it and be glad. Their hearts shall rejoice in the Lord. I will whistle for them and gather them in, for I have redeemed them, and they shall be as many as they go before. Though I scattered them among the nations, Yet in far countries they shall remember me, and with their children they shall live and return. I will bring them home from the land of Egypt, and gather them from Assyria, and I will bring them to the land of Gilead and to Lebanon, till there is no room for them. He shall pass through the Sea of Troubles, and strike down the waves of the sea, and all the depths of the Nile shall be dried up. The pride of Assyria shall be laid low, and the scepter of Egypt shall depart. I will make them strong in the Lord, and they shall walk in his name, declares the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. How often do you look at a map of New Jersey? I've been looking at a map of New Jersey a lot lately. Of course, I have to. I don't know where I'm going. I'm just learning. But now, let's take this and put this in another frame of reference. Have you ever looked at an old map of New Jersey? And I'm not talking like 1950s. I'm talking like 1850s. What does it look like? A little different. A couple of years ago, I had a reason to look up an old map of Michigan from before Michigan had officially achieved statehood. It's a beautiful old map. I could find all of my favorite places on that map. Now, it's old enough that some of the counties had much different borders, and their names were all different. Some of the places I did not recognize. Of course, with old maps, things are often distorted. The size and the shape of the landmass is often imagined by guesswork, as much as it is by careful cartographical observation and measurement. Sometimes, the bias of the map maker comes out in the placement and size of one county over another. Sometimes his physical perspective shaped his topography. If he sailed the coastline of Michigan in a boat, he may have accurately read all of the inlets and river mouths and rocky outcrops on his maps. But he may still have hardly any idea of the real shape and size of the interior and so on. So, old maps are often given to distortion. But as we explore the terrain of God's salvation, sometimes it feels like we're one of those old map makers. I mean, let's be frank, we get some things right, but some things we invent out of our own bias. We distort things. We overemphasize things. We minimize things. Sometimes we even ignore other features of the landscape of God's grace. And a lot of times, our personal map of God's way of salvation is unreliable. See, what we need is we need a bird's eye view, a view from above, a view from a helicopter, so that we can accurately depict what the landscape looks like. Well, in Zechariah 6, verses 6 through 12, God gives us a satellite view, a view from above, a map perfect and complete of God's saving way and his saving plan. See, in the first 5 verses of Zechariah 10, God depicted himself as the good shepherd who cares for his flock. Unlike false shepherds, the human leaders and the rulers of the people of Israel who deserted them for idolatry, the Lord cares tenderly for his people. And in the second half of the chapter, we see God as shepherd caring for his flock.
only now in greater detail. Now we see all the features of the landscape of God's attentive love for the sheep of his fold. Now notice that first verse I read to you, verse 6. I will strengthen the house of Judah. And then in verse 12, I will strengthen them or make them strong in the Lord. Zechariah begins and ends with the clear affirmation of God's commitment to providing his own strength for his own people. Those are the bookends that bracket this passage. And between them follows a string of promises spoken by the Lord to his people that explain how he is going to strengthen them. And each one begins with, I will. They tell us what God means when he says, I will strengthen my people. 6 more times in English, that phrase is repeated. 6 more times, God declares his intention to act. In verse 6, I will answer them. In verse 8, I will whistle for them and gather them in, for I have redeemed them. Verse 10, I will bring them home from the land of Egypt and gather them from Assyria, and I will bring them to the land of Gilead, to the land of Lebanon. The strengthening work of God in the lives of his people is a saving work, a redeeming work, a restoring work, a work that brings them home. See, there's that great repeating feature, this characteristic mark of the topography of salvation appearing again and again, God's resounding promise, I will strengthen, I will save, I will redeem, I will bring them back. And there is no doubt about the author and the initiator of salvation. It is the work of the one who declares to sinners in need of saving, I will. It is God's gracious work. It is his initiative. It is his grace. Salvation belongs to the Lord. That was Paul's point in Ephesians 2. We were dead in our trespasses and our sins. We were by nature children of wrath. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even though we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved, and he raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places with Christ Jesus, so that in the coming age he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works which God prepared beforehand, that we may walk in them. And here is the bold truth. You are not able to qualify for God's salvation. That's bad news. You're not able to qualify for God's salvation. You deserve nothing. Kind of like Willy Wonka, you get nothing. You deserve nothing but his displeasure and his wrath. You can no more claim your own rescue than Lazarus could rouse himself from death and walk out of the tomb under his own power. You were dead and helpless, totally and completely unable. That's the bad news. The good news is that God, who is rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loves us, delights to rescue dead sinners and make them alive in union with Christ to give them the gift of saving faith. You don't earn salvation. That's a fool's errand. You couldn't do it if you spent five lifetimes trying, because it's a gift. It's free. It's gracious. It's offered generously to all and any, because salvation belongs to the Lord. He is willing. That's his point. Over and over and over again, God says to his people, I am willing, I will save, I will strengthen, I will save, I will redeem, I will bring them back. He is willing to save you. Isn't that good news? He is willing to save all who come to God by Jesus Christ. I will whistle for them and gather them in, for I have redeemed them. They shall be as many as they were before. Though I scattered them among the nations, yet in far countries they shall remember me, and with their children they shall live and return. I will bring them home from the land of Egypt and gather them from Assyria. I will bring them to the land of Gilead and to Lebanon till there is no room for them. Once again, God is the good shepherd. This time Zechariah saw him whistling for his flock. And Jesus also spoke about his own saving work in similar terms. He is the good shepherd. The sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. And the sheep follow him because they know his voice. There is a call of God that goes out to all people who hear the gospel preached. Not all who hear that call are going to answer. But when Christ's sheep hear the call of the gospel in God's timing, by the work of the Holy Spirit, it never falls on deaf ears. It is compelling and it is effective. It draws them, it attracts them, it inclines them to come. As the gospel is preached, some hear the call of the Good Shepherd himself, and they flock to his side, called out of darkness into his marvelous light, called into fellowship with Jesus Christ. In and with and through the preaching of the gospel, there comes an effective call. A call that creates the reality that it calls for. Because when he calls, they come. And just to remind you, I want to highlight three things that happen when God saves and restores us. The very first thing is that we enjoy a restored communion with God. Verse 6 again says, they shall be as though I had not rejected them. I am the Lord their God, and I will answer them. Restored communion with God is what you get when God saves you. The Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of Sonship, dwells in your heart and cries out, Abba, Father. And he hears you. Second thing, joy will be a mark of your life. Those who are redeemed have reasons and grounds for joy. Verse 7 says, their hearts shall be glad as with wine. Their children shall see it. Their hearts shall rejoice in the Lord. Christians, of all the people in the world, have a reason for joy. It ought to show every now and again, even if we are Lutherans, joy. You have been saved and you have been rescued. And you have been adopted into a family and a household of the King of Glory. You are his child. Rejoice. And number three is that we have obedience instead of rebellion. Verse 12 says, I will make them strong in the Lord and they will walk in his name. You will walk in his name because he will make you strong. You are a new creation in Christ, and the Spirit of God dwells in you. See what I mean when I say that when we follow an old, outdated map, our vision of what we're looking at sometimes gets distorted. We miss many times the free, gracious character of God's saving gift in Jesus. If we think that we have to earn it, we're burdened with shame and guilt and failure. If we think that we have to qualify for the love of the Father, we find ourselves fearful and robbed. Robbed of assurance. Wondering deep down if God the Father isn't still suspicious of us. How badly do we need that crystal clear satellite image of God's gracious salvation? Well, in Zechariah 10, we have a pretty good glimpse of that. Take it all in. See what God has done. See what God is doing. See that salvation is all a free gift to any and everyone who trusts in Jesus. Rest in the underlying, impenetrable, unfathomable love and compassion of God towards us in Christ. Rest in the complete, perfect redemption won by Jesus. For when you do, you will know that you are safe and you are secure. You will find yourself filled with gladness. And may the Lord help you to lift your eyes to the hills and see where your help comes from. Because your help comes from the Lord, who made the heavens and the earth. In Jesus' name, amen. Please rise. And now may the peace of God that passes all understanding guard and keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty.
Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs.
O Lord, deliver us from contending that we are righteous before you because of who we are and what we have done. Surely we are sinners who only deserve your wrath. Cause us to turn from our worthlessness and hold fast to the surpassing worth of Christ Jesus and his righteousness for us.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, you gave your Son to be rejected by sinners, that we sinners might be welcomed into your kingdom. Preserve your church in this life won for us by Christ, crucified and risen. Give faithfulness to the preaching of your word and the administration of your sacraments. And let your people receive these gifts with penitence and faith.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, salvation belongs to you. Your blessing be on your people. Endow parents with every good gift to teach their children your ways, that they may live in the confidence of your grace and salvation.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, you shield us and lift our heads. Provide for us civil authorities who discourage evil and encourage good. But keep us ever mindful that our hope is in you.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, you sustain us each day, granting us sleep and waking us again. Be the consolation of those who live in anxiety and fear, assuring them of your mercy and deliverance in Christ.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, bestow your kindness to all those in any need, especially Bjorg, Claire, Gladys, the family of Charlotte Wolfenstein, and all that we name now in our hearts.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, you do not extinguish us like a wick for our sin, but you enlighten us for the sake of Jesus. Grant that our light may shine before others, that they may see our works and glorify you.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, St. Paul counted all things as rubbish in order that he might gain Christ. Give us repentant hearts that we would abandon all confidence in our flesh and so receive your Son's body and blood for the forgiveness of our sins.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. O Lord, in your baptism you have shared Christ's suffering, death, and resurrection with us, that we might be raised from the dead. Preserve us from taking his sacrifice for granted. Encourage us to forget what lies behind and strain forward to what lies ahead, until we attain the resurrection from the dead.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Please rise. And now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you steadfast in true faith to life everlasting. Depart now in his peace. Amen. Amen. Upon you and grant you his peace.
Amen.
Amen.